another edition of the Loose Cannons Podcast. I'm your host, Sammer, and I'm hanging with my boys, Stank and Christian. What's up, guys?
Hey, Sammer. How's you doing?
Good there, Sammer.
How's you doing? Hey, man, I told you no Spanish children. You bring your Spanish children on here before we even get on here. And now you guys are making fun of me. I don't know about all this, man. I'm just going to start doing a solo podcast.
Why can't it just be children? Why has it got to be Spanish children? So does it matter?
Your kids are Spanish.
Yeah. You know you can't make racial jokes in this time.
No.
Sammer.
I mean, I can. I get racially profiled daily.
Nope. X-nay on Nope.
Nope. I don't know what you guys are doing. I know what that means. Is my collar
on? Cut it out.
Oh, we're going to Full House reference. Check it out, man. Whatever. Let's talk football. Let's talk football.
All right. So
Christian is not afraid of coronavirus. That's the headline right here. Christian's not afraid of coronavirus.
I'm not. Listen, it's not that I'm not afraid of coronavirus. I respect it, right? It's like anything else. It's just you got to be more mindful and stuff like that. But God damn it, if the stadiums are open. I've had this conversation with Stank. I've had this conversation with you. If they tell me I can go, then I have a choice. And I'm fucking going. I am going. I'm going to the spray paint fucking pewter booth. I'm going to spray paint my entire fucking jello body in fucking pewter, followed by Beck's baby oil. Because, I'm a big dude, so I need to slide in the seat real nice and easy. You know what I'm saying? So the baby oil helps with that. Plus it helps with my tan. I need that full tan. You know what I'm saying? And I'm going to watch my fucking Bucks. Listen, my business partner said it best. I've invested into this team, right? It's like I've been dropping money into a slot machine. Just dropping money in. And I finally get to cash something in, and I'm not going to go to the game? Fuck you. If I got to wear a mask, I'm wearing a mask. If I got to carry goddamn fucking hand sanitizer in my pocket, then I'm going to do it. If I got to be more mindful, then I'll be more mindful. It's not fear. It's just I have a choice.
We need to buy hazmat suits and have them like custom painted to look like Buck uniforms.
You mean like the
helmet era? Part and everything, dude?
We survived MRSA, guys. Okay,
I have those in my van right now. Tyvek suits. We can customize them. Put Beck's mustached face right on one breast. You know,
just
Bruce right Cannons and Buck and Idiots on the back.
So I take it you guys are going too then.
I'm going, bro. I'm touching handrails. I'm not washing my hands after I pee.
Whoa.
All the normal things.
Dude, there's ways to get around this. We can just look like all those other super fans. We'll just get the Nike gloves. We'll look like wide receivers out there that aren't wide receivers, clearly. Huh. We can give high fives to everybody. We can sanitize here and there. And when we yell, we just don't yell close to other dudes' mouths.
I'm interested about what Stank was talking about. He's bad. We'll touch handrails.
Listen, I want to challenge. Look.
Touch
I want to challenge my fucking immune system. Give me the germs. I need my immune system to be strong.
I just thought about The Office.
Strong. Yes. Thank you. Dwight Schrute. The Dwight Schrute. Look, spit in my mouth real quick. Spit in my mouth.
Just do it.
Spit in my mouth.
You got it, bro. Hey, thanks for that massage earlier today, by the way. You're so welcome, man.
Listen, my feet have healing powers, bro. My feet are good. I can heal.
You were using your feet?
Those were my feet. Yeah.
Yeah, monkey feet, bro.
Yeah, I can grip. I can grip.
Grip and shit.
They're so soft.
They're very soft.
How many knuckles do your toes have? That was so weird.
Triple jointed.
Wow. Impressive. Wow. Impressive, to say the least. No, exactly. For those of you who have not caught on to what the fuck we're talking about, the NFL came out and said that they expect stadiums to have fans in them in some capacity or another. And Christian had tweeted out earlier in the week that there's nothing that's going to keep him from the stadium, and it's absolutely his call to make, you know, that risky decision or not, you know, whether he goes or doesn't go. I totally agree, man. I think a lot of fans agree. And you just take your chances, especially the fucking 13 or 14 years of bullshit that we fucking put up with. And now we have a chance to win some games, and you're telling me I can't be there? Mm-hmm. They better figure out a way to get everyone in that stadium.
It's the devil's work.
The majority of the people that I've talked to or I've come in contact with or had this subject come up, they're kind of along the same lines of us. Uncle Lou, you know, Brother Lou put it best the other day when I posted that up. When I posted that up on Twitter, he said, listen, if I can survive Walmart, I'm going to fucking Ray J. Like, if I can survive the cesspool that is Walmart, where nobody is fucking following social distancing, nobody maybe not nobody, but a lot of people aren't wearing masks. Nobody gives a fuck, bro. Walmart is like, have you watched, have you like, do you follow the Facebook page or the IG page? Or
Walmart hasn't changed though. It's been the same shit for years.
I mean, the people of Walmart, it's the same shit, yeah, bro. It's like insane. That, yeah. So like, I got a Subway sandwich from fucking Walmart and the chick was literally ringing me up, grabbed my money, went back, didn't wash her hands, didn't change gloves, made another sub. What do you want? Oh, you want that shit toasted? Blah, 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 blah. I'm like,
you like, still ate, you know, it
6 months ago. I wouldn't have given a fuck, right? But you're so hypersensitive to this shit now. It's like you notice everything, right? Fuck yeah, I ate it. I ate it. You know why? Because I wanted to challenge my immune system.
I'll say this: nobody's listening to this podcast to get advice on how to deal with coronavirus, and you shouldn't. But we're gonna share our opinions with you, whether you like it or not.
If you want to go
in our opinions, right?
Hey, I got no hate for you.
Keep your elderly parents at home. If you have an immune deficiency, stay the fucking home. Otherwise,
yeah. And dude, we're gonna be covered in that pewter body paint. You think that shit's not protecting us? You're fucking crazy. That shit is protection, layer by layer of.
Stephen Beck does not endorse anything we're saying right now.
Nothing at all.
If Stephen Beck's watching this, we are being irresponsible.
You think he watches any of these?
No, he never watched. He's never watched a single one.
No way. No way, man. Stephen Beck right now
is literally like Karen.
He was so reporting mad
us.
About
contacting the CDC.
But dude, his mustache. You have to give him credit. He's got that mustache. Shit.
The stash?
It's fucking impressive. Yeah.
That is fucking A game, A grade.
Burt Reynolds grade. That is legit. Stash.
And you speaking of that, did you hear what he said about the cars? There was like the four cars. Which one do you take? And he's like, Kit, not even a question. It's the stash, bro.
It was a bad
wrong.
Choice.
You know
though.
He's wrong, right? It's the DeLorean every time. Every time it's the DeLorean. Every time.
It's a time machine, bro.
It's the time.
Every time.
There was a time machine on the list.
I would go back and make sure Brett Favre made it to the Bucs. Brett Favre. I would go back and make sure that we drafted Aaron Rodgers. I would do that.
I'd go into the future, and I would attend the Hall of Fame induction ceremony for Matt Gay. That's what I would go to. That's honestly what I would want.
You could literally go back and make sure that your general manager drafts Ray Lewis, Barry Sanders, like all of them. He's going to get them all right.
I'm going to go in the future. I'm going to go into the future and literally go, speaking of Hall of Fame induction speeches, go watch my very rapidly becoming my favorite Bucks player right now on defense. I would go watch Devin White's Hall of Fame induction speech. Speaking of Devin White, what do you guys think about his comments? All these people, NFL Network, all the fans, everybody is out here going fucking crazy, getting all chubbed up. We got 12. We got the fucking GOAT. We got all the weapons. And Devin White, I love that kid. He said, whoa, 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 whoa.
Y'all forgetting about somebody.
Pump the brakes. Mm-hmm. I feel like the defense is going to carry this fucking team.
That's a bold statement from him, just because, first off, he's a second-year kid. He just went through his first year in the NFL. So I feel like, you know, maybe he's still got that young confidence shit going on. But I fucking like it, though. Like, when was the last time we had a defensive player come out and basically – put their dick on the fucking table, like, we got this shit now.
Maybe Akeem Tlaib.
Jerome McCoy.
Yeah, Akeem Tlaib was like, yeah, that's
Jerome McCoy was saying sorry to people, bro. I don't remember.
Jerome McCoy was dick so on full the table. Of shit, bro. Stop. No one here likes Jerome.
Jerome laid it on the line.
Listen, all right, wait, stop.
You have to be sarcastic right now.
Don't do this. Don't do this.
The video you retweeted, you were like, there it is, folks. He said it himself,
bro. He was listing his own best plays, and they were terrible. Like, okay, I had three sacks.
You know what's
crazy? The 49ers.
I don't remember any of the moments he listed. I didn't remember a single one. I was like, when the fuck did he have three sacks in one fucking game? I bet you that season he ended with four sacks. I guarantee it was like four or five sacks. Yeah.
No, he fucking tore his bicep on the fucking next play after the third sack. Man.
Legit, though. Last guy to put his dick on the line, probably Akeem Tlaib. Akeem Tlaib had that kind of
swagger.
Fuck everyone swag.
Yeah, he was a fuck you swagger, for sure.
If you ain't with me like Steve Smith, if you ain't with me, I'm swinging a fucking helmet at you, bro.
And me and my mom will bust the cap in you, bro.
Both of us.
Me and my mom will.
I'm curious, though, in Todd Bowles' schemes, his defenses, when he's the defensive coordinator, is the second year the year they kind of, like, gel and really work? Because I feel like – I don't know if we can compare it so much to the Arizona team because they had so much talent in the secondary. But maybe this team is that talented in the secondary. We just now are finally going to see it, especially those two guys that are now in their second year, Carlton Davis in the second year under a real defensive coordinator. I mean, I don't think what he said is that far-fetched. They are like on paper a really fucking good group.
Listen, our front seven it's unquestioned. It's all in the secondary, right? And if you look at the secondary, Jamel Dean didn't start until Seattle. That horror show, right? But after the Seattle game, like he had something insane, like 13 or 14 pass breakups, and like
he literally had more pass breakups.
Than everybody. He led the league in pass breakups, and he only started after the Seattle game, which is insane. So,
yeah, but according to Todd Bowles' press conference today, Sean Murphy Bunting will be starting over him on the outside. Did I not hear that correctly?
He said they would interchange depending on the situation. They would interchange. He said,
"Yeah, man, they run a scheme where they're in nickel often enough to where I think they'll end up playing 50-50 between the two of them. They're going to get the same amount of playing time."
He said the same thing with the safeties. It's interchangeable. Both strong and free have to learn both positions. And depending on the matchup, you're playing strong this week, you're playing free. Wait, this matchup, you're playing free, you're playing strong. So it's very interchangeable. And I found interesting about Todd Bowles' press conference today was they said, so what do you think or why do you think that the defense or the secondary would improve next year, including Devin White and some of our young corners? And he said, they were young pups. He referred to them as young pups, young puppies. He said last year they were just learning how to do what they're supposed to do. That makes sense. Mm-hmm. They were learning and they were trying to sink or swim, drinking through a fire hose on the scheme, technique, on what it meant to play at this level in the NFL. He said this year they get to focus on what the offense is trying to do to attack them. In other words, I know what I'm doing now. Now I can break down film and figure out and get in the mind of the quarterback and the offensive coordinator for the other team and play faster, play freer.
Now they can actually like study film and play against the opponent as opposed to playing against the opponent and also thinking about what they're doing is what you're saying. Everything's now.
Yeah, they're not learning the intricacies of the defense and where they're supposed to be and – yeah, everybody was learning last year on both sides of the ball. New offense, new defense. This year, it's only Brady's learning, and then our rookies and our free agent additions, the sporadic ones that we've added to this team. So, we should be a step ahead of where we were last year at this time, outside of Brady.
I think one of the guys that people are kind of writing off because we drafted Winfield and people seem to be pretty happy with Whitehead. Is Mike Edwards. I feel like they're kind of writing him off, but the kid's a dog. Everywhere he's been a dog. So you think he's not going to just let down and chill. He's going to fight. And that ends up – I think that works in our favor because he does play a lot of safeties. They can rotate those guys. Mike Edwards is going to see the field in some capacity. He's not just going to give his job away or his chance for a job away. This is I'm excited about the safety position for the first time in – 15 years here since Sennard Jackson. How about that?
If he would just stop smoking weed, that kid was special. He
smoked the weed, man. God,
the weed.
And in this day and age, he would have been able to fly under the radar. Now they've loosened the rules on the fucking green.
It's not loosened. You can just smoke now.
He would have gotten a lot of 15-yard penalties nowadays, though, man. Sennard? He was reckless. Well,
he wasn't that much
in a good way. It fit back then. He hit people.
You're right. I remember Dallas Clark. He laid Dallas Clark the fuck out.
The rules have changed so much in the last 2-3 years. Who knows if Evans comes back, if he's even – I mean, he's a thumper, bro. Is he even going to be able to exist in this NFL?
Starting safeties next year for me, at some point before the end of the year, it's going to be Mike Edwards and Antoine Winfield. By the way, the Bucs are beating the Green Bay Packers in the third quarter of the NFC Championship in the Madden Bowl simulation.
I don't want any part of it, bro. Part of any kind of Madden,
keep
anything.
That bullshit juju away from us,
cursed,
bro.
Keep those curses 14, away. 7.
Doesn't matter. I'm a 2K guy anyways, and they fucked us. They signed for another 6 years because they followed the money.
No, but 2K can make a game in 2021, so you're fine.
They I'm a Tecmo Bowl guy.
No, they can, I thought they said they could make a game in 2021.
They can, but non-simulation.
I'll take it.
I will. NFL Street,
Do you guys remember when the first NFL 2K came out and it was Randy Moss on the Sega Dreamcast? And you're like, holy shit, this is how the football should be fucking laid out on a video game. Holy shit. And it was
the Terrell Owens one was the best ever. The TO one on the cover. It's still so better than Madden in certain aspects.
Dude, I miss my Sega Dreamcast just because of NFL 2K, whatever the fuck the last one was. Dude, I miss it just because of that game. It was so good. So good, man. And the Bucks defense and Simeon Rice in that game. Oh my God.
Mike Allstott.
I miss you could reach out and just swipe. Oh my God.
Mike Allstott.
Everything was so clean. It was so well done, man. But EA, they know how to get the signatures on the pieces of paper that matter, man. But
that's how.
That's what happens when you have monopolies, man.
Yeah. That is what happens. So
But we talked about what we thought about this Devin White nonsense, or not nonsense, but you know, him laying his dick on the table. But I don't Stank didn't really did like are you cool with what he said, or were you because you're usually really held back. You're really reserved about the defense. So
I'm not. Me and Christian actually had this conversation earlier, and I'm gonna reiterate what I told him earlier. Devin White is gonna fill the void for everything we love about Jameis Winston. Okay, that enthusiasm, that love for the team, the camaraderie that he'll ride or die for, bleed for his buddies out there, his boys.
That country boy.
You know, yeah, that country just old love of football. Devin White's that guy, right? I mean, him and Jameis were a lot alike in those ways. So I love Devin White. I'm not putting any cap on that guy's game. If he can stay healthy, really, I mean, he should have a Pro Bowl type season. So no, I mean, I didn't mean to stay quiet because I didn't agree. I absolutely agree. Big things are coming, but not so much him.
I'm asking because you've held back in terms of your confidence in this defense for even last year.
And still concerned about the secondary. Still concerned. They're very young. I still think they're maybe missing some veteran leadership back there. But we talked about this earlier because I was like, "Oh, Christian, I heard Pat Pete still talking about how he's doesn't have a new contract," and in the back of my mind, I'm still daydreaming or, you know, having wet dreams of Pat Pete coming here and adding that piece to this defensive secondary. I think it would be great, but I don't think it's happening. They're going to ride with the Young Bucks, and that's fine. And it's not going to be pretty at times. I think we're still not there 100%. We'll see.
But like, you know, you can kind of cover some of that stuff with your front seven. If they really get after the quarterback and that front seven, you know, takes the next step in the defense and they're blitzing and they're, you know, they're on their game, the secondary, if they have bad, you know, reads here and there, I think it kind of gets covered up a little bit. You can kind of, you know, cover it and I don't know what the word would be, I guess, but they can safeguard against that kind of shit. But if you bring in a guy like Pat Pete, a guy who has to start, I feel like that's a detriment to those youngsters because I feel like they should play. They will gain more knowledge and better understanding of everything that they have to do as professionals if they're on the field when it matters. And especially last year, they learned, you know, in the fire, and then you're going to tell them to take a step back. I don't like that. I feel if you're going to get a secondary guy, get a veteran who's going to come in and teach them how to study and teach them how to be a pro, but more or less fill that void if, like, you know, somebody gets injured or kind of play more of that I'm the immediate backup. Somebody that can kind of guide, but is there as a veteran depth piece. I don't think Patrick Peterson's that guy because, first off, he comes with such an ego, which I fucking love. I'm a huge Peterson fan, but he's not, you know, he's not going to come in here and just chill. He's going to demand starting and playing time, and that takes away from a guy like SMB, who I think got better as he played more. And Jim Eldeen, the more he played, the better he got. When he was on the bench, you could tell it was like it wasn't helping him. He wasn't learning from film as much as he was learning on the field. So,
yeah, I'm just a little apprehensive. I it's not like I don't believe. I still have a little bit of PTSD from what happened in the first half of last season. We didn't play the best of competition towards the end of the season. It's not that I don't think that they have the ability to play at a high level.
They held the Texans. They held the Texans.
Denard Hopkins, DeAndre Hopkins to 23 yards.
The other games, I understand. The other games, I understood. Yeah, they played suspect offenses. But that one week when they played Houston, they fucking locked down a serious quarterback.
Deshaun Watson's arm doesn't scare me. I get that offense. He plays well within it, but, you know.
Still okay, but – DeAndre Hopkins puts up tons of numbers. Somebody's throwing him the ball.
Yeah. Didn't they have a good game against Atlanta too? We were shutting down Atlanta. And that's Julio Jones and Ridley. And I mean, they did this thing. NFL competition. Mm-hmm. NFL competition. You know what else makes the secondary better? Limited exposure. How about you don't put your defense out there for fucking 85, 90 snaps a game because you're turning the ball over?
Oof,
don't turn the ball over.
Yeah, and not only that, Christian, but if we have control of the game, we're taking advantage of our opportunities on offense, we go up early on teams like they seem to do on us all the time, and you put offenses in positions where you know what's coming, make them one-dimensional, make them have to throw the ball to play
catch-up. Make them predictable. Right?
Then your sack numbers go way up. You know, your corners and your safeties can be more opportunistic. They know what's coming at them because teams can't be balanced against you, which is what teams did to us all the time. And that makes playing defense so much easier when you're not really worried about the threat of the short passing game or the dink and dunk because they need points and they need points quick. That's when your rushers can pin their ears back. That's when Todd Bowles can really, you know, do some crazy shit back there. And, yeah, we did not see Todd Bowles' full defense last year. I think he threw a lot at the guys in the first half of the season, had to pull back and simplify a little bit.
My daughter painted something. You can show this.
Oh, that looks incredible.
She just painted that.
That looks awesome.
I always like paintings that don't have eyes.
It's beautiful. It's beautiful. Say hello to – we have three million downloads. 3 million people watch this podcast. So say hello to all three million.
Right now, live.
You're live right now.
Live right now on the internet.
She's like, okay, I'm going to get out of here.
I love you. Goodbye.
Samra's like, I'm not editing that shit out of there.
Hey, she's the most gullible child on the planet. If she ever watches this, I hope she doesn't hear me say that. But she's the type – she's the type that – would get like indoctrinated into a cult. You'd be like, what? Jesus is really coming?
She looks a lot like Sasha, drink this juice.
Wow. She'd be the type. She's so innocent, so beautiful, and it scares the shit out of me. All right. On to what we were talking about.
I don't even remember at this point. I think, it kind of leads into another thing that came up this week. And, oh, man, like Bucks Twitter in the offseason, man, even when we have good things, they still do dumb shit. It's like, we can't have nice things. We don't even deserve nice things sometimes.
That was a troll. The whole thing was a troll. People got out of shape for no reason.
Christian mentioned it. The defense plays better when they're not out there 80 times a game and they're not, you know, back against the wall and you're not throwing the ball to the opposite team. And that kind of leads into what I don't feel it was shade thrown at Jameis when Shaq Barrett said, with Tom Brady, we are immediately Super Bowl contenders, but with Jameis, we would have been playoff contenders. People took that the wrong way for some reason. And maybe I'm just optimistic. Shade? People thought it was throwing shade at Jameis. Like, oh, man, I can't wait. Shade? Thank God he's gone. Now we're Super Bowl contenders. But he said he's not wrong. It's like if LeBron James joins your team, you're automatically you're going to be in the finals or close to it. Tom Brady's the same shit, right? Like, why is this wrong?
Because I don't think it was wrong
about Jameis. People are hypersensitive about Jameis. I'm done. I'm over the fucking shit already, dude. All you fuckers out there, listen to me really carefully.
We know that.
Fuck you guys.
Here we go.
Go be fucking Saints fans. Seriously. I'm just done with it, bro. Like, I saw something else that said, oh, I saw all you fuckers out there that are jocking Brady now. 2 months ago, you were saying he was done. I'm gonna look up your tweets. Fuck you too, dude. Like, I'm over it.
I mean, even if you were saying that,
fan, coddle the fucking balls, go do the baseball swing shit with him, go do the crazy boxing. He can't throw a punch, by the way, at all. He looks really fucking awkward throwing a punch. And go be a fucking Saints fan. Go being a fucking, go, just go. Go.
Here's the thing, though. Even if you were saying stuff, I mean, I was in that camp. I was saying, I don't know if Tom can do it. I don't know if Tom will fit. Like, we didn't have the information.
Like, I was not.
Yeah. He wasn't telling, you know, we didn't know that he was telling BA, hey, I'm going to bring some of this. And BA saying, yeah, I'll adjust. We didn't know any of that shit. Of course, we're going to say some of that stuff. But he's here. So we're supposed to now continue hating him. I never hated him to begin with. Stank has like a fucking terrible relationship with Tom Brady for some reason.
I do, but it's not that I hate his game.
I've always loved him.
You could go back and listen to all the vodcasts and podcasts. I don't hate Tom Brady's game. I just didn't think he was a fit for this offense. I didn't think he would come here to begin with. And that's what I said from the beginning. I didn't think – I'm not the one who said, oh, he's broken down, he has no arm, blah, blah, blah. No, I don't buy that shit. I think he's in a way better position – you know, in regards to weapons in this offense than he was in New England last year. Nobody can argue that. And yes, bringing a guy who's got 6 Super Bowl rings onto your roster is going to give you a little bit better chance at possibly getting to the Super Bowl.
It's not a little bit. It's
no shit, but I'm being dramatic.
Expectation.
No,
yeah.
No, Shaq. No, you're wrong, Shaq. He just makes us playoff contenders like Jameis. No big deal.
Dude, they were hating on this guy. They're calling him one-hit wonder. Like, 1 year, the splash in a pan, all that shit. I'm like,
shout out to my boy, Joel.
He's on our fucking team. Check out the
last Buckin' Idiots podcast where I had Joel on there. Joel likes to run his mouth, likes to talk shit. That's all he was doing. Matter of fact, the very next tweet was him giving Shaq love, saying basically he was trolling him and fucking with him. So everybody just blew that shit.
I mean, I know, man, but some of that shit is like, to him and people who know him, like you, for instance, like you get it, but there's so many, like, I don't like to say that we have dumb fans, but every fan base has dumb fans. They see some shit like that, they run with it.
He's not one of them. There are a lot of dumb ones out there.
There are others.
He likes to push buttons. He's the same one who got into it with Jake Arians, which was some of the funniest shit I've ever seen on Twitter. He just likes to instigate.
Didn't Jake want to fight him?
Yes.
Jake's girl. Jake's wife wanted to fight him, dude.
And Jake.
Yeah.
And he said, roll up.
I think his wife would have taken Breeze. What's his name? Breeze overrated? Joel?
Now he's Breeze overrated. He used to be Jameis in the cut.
Here's a take.
That's him? Hold on. That's who that is?
Yes.
Oh! Now I get it. I didn't know that was the same fucking dude. I thought Jameis in the cut just left.
He loves Jameis, but he changed his name when Jameis left here.
But he's gone.
He's the biggest Bucks fan. One of the biggest Bucks fans I know.
He's not.
Whatever. No, I'm serious. Have him on the podcast. He is.
Here's one for you guys.
Give him a chance.
And for you out there, man. All the ones saying that it's going to be a different kind of offense and, you know, it's going to be more control and it's just going to be, you know, dumb. Listen. I got a feeling they aren't going to throttle back, if that makes sense. There's not going to be like, oh, we're up 14. Let's start running the ball. No, they're not going to throttle back. That is not Bruce Arians' personality. And Tom Brady did not come here to be check down Charlie like they called him in New England when he took what was available. They're not going to throttle back, bro.
I'm okay with taking what's available.
Yeah, no, I'm okay with that as well. What I'm trying to say is they're not going to, you know, crab up like, oh, we're up by 14. I don't see that at all, man.
I mean, their attitude's going to be very similar year. Tom's not that guy that, like, you know, shrinks or shrivels in, like, big moments or, like, when he has a lead and clutch. So the team's attitude will change. But since I think they will run the ball. I mean – last year when we had leads, Bruce expected the defense to hold and we were just going to run the ball and go conservative. Maybe some of that was because he didn't want Jameis throwing the ball and he was afraid that Jameis could cost us the game. But I feel – I understand. I think 50-50 is going to happen. I think they will try to run the ball more when they have a lead.
Yeah, but when you got a quarterback back there throwing hand grenades, but sometimes he drops those hand grenades into the huddle, you get a little bit of gun shy, right?
I totally get that. I still think they want to run the ball. I'm not saying they're going to pull back per se. So like the shots will still be there, but I don't think it'll be even close to like how they were turtling up in the second half of games last year, even when they had leads and they had a chance to like step on the throat.
Bucks just went to the Super Bowl.
That Byron was just not interested. Don't tell us that shit, Christian. No one cares. No one wants to know about this fucking bad sign.
That's a bad omen. Listen, just like you saying, listen, Christian, you got to understand. Listen, no, man. Energy is real. That's bad mojo. Just like you saying earlier, like, I don't know if you know this, but you fucked up the whole Devonta Freeman thing. You did that.
We never offered
you. No, you did. Before you tweeted out, that he had reminded you of Clyde Edwards-Helaire,
I was just trolling Sandler. Everything was fine. Literally trolling him.
Everything was fine. And as soon as you tweeted it out, Greg Allman's like, nope, it's bullshit. Fuck you.
I knew that as soon as Sandler saw that tweet, wherever he was going to be like,
I stopped. I stopped what I was doing. I was in the shower when I saw it. I stopped what I was
doing. He's in his shower.
Fucking mentioned.
I was mid crude oil rub. I'm like, what? What's this shit? Hold on.
Clyde Edwards again?
Everything reminds you of Clyde Edwards-Helaire, motherfucker.
So do you.
Yeah, man. Okay. That softened it, bro. You hurt my feelings at first, and then it felt better. I was okay with it, man. I was good.
And listen.
I finished my shower with a smile. I'll tell you that much.
Good for you.
Hey, let's go back to how he's reading your tweets in the shower.
Yeah, I don't want to think about
it. I have my best friends on tweet notifications. Is that wrong? Don't you guys have my tweets on notification?
I do. Every time you tweet, it pops up.
I hate push notifications. I have nothing on notification. Zero.
Fuck you then. We're not friends.
Except for text messages.
You're a piece of shit. You know that? I'm going to have you replaced before the season starts.
Wow. Wow. Wow.
Shit. If you want to be my best friend, you have to put my tweets on notification, bro. That's like a fucking requirement.
He's unreplaceable. You can't replace him.
Exactly.
Unreplaceable. I'm irreplaceable. Let us speak English, Spanish kid. Come on. We're unreplaceable. I'm going off on you motherfuckers today. Fuck this shit. I'm done. He is untouchable, but come on.
And by the way, you fucking A-Rab. We're not going to be anywhere near 50.
Wow.
You're going to fucking come at me saying I can't speak.
Wow.
Just because I haven't had a s'more, you're gonna fucking call me an Arab? Because I haven't had a fucking s'mores before?
Yes. I didn't say that.
We're not going to be anywhere near. Back to the shit. We're not going to be anywhere near.
You should be eating some s'mores, motherfucker.
You should. You should have a fucking s'more. By the way, Stank.
I don't camp.
Totally, you know, not official and just kind of weird on the podcast. But whatever. This is what we do on here.
Yeah.
Samer wants to get together so we can cross some recipes. He's like,
he wanted to get together and cross bones.
I know what Samer wants to get together and cross.
Yeah. But no, seriously, cross. Come over to the house.
Wanted to dock our sauces Sasha, together.
Kids, make some chicken wings and shit. Maybe watch some 2002 football. What's up?
Porn.
That is porn.
Or football.
Football. I meant football. That is absolutely porn. Absolutely.
But I would love to make a wager with you, Samer. You want to make a wager?
Wait. What? Since we're talking about old school football, I have to mention this because I wanted to say this earlier. Listen, we were talking about like Tanar Jackson not working now. I've been watching a lot of like 2002, 2001 Buck football on YouTube on that Mike Pease's this channel. Dude, fucking awesome. Such an awesome like YouTube resource for Bucks fans. Look it up. It's Mike P. It's an awesome channel. Anyway, dude, John Lynch would never be able to play in this era.
No,
there's no way. None. Every fucking hit that guy laid out, I was like, holy shit, where's the flag? Where's the flag? Where's the flag?
He would get offended.
Dude, he would be banned in two games.
Same with Atwater. Same with fucking all the old school headhunters.
You know who could play? Ed Reed.
Yeah, Ed Reed was a ball hawk.
The U.
Dude, I mean, you know, watching a lot of those games, though, I know this is like really, I don't know if I want to say this, but did I cut you off, man?
No, you didn't. I've just been trying to make a wager with you. You keep ducking me.
I'll get it. Don't worry. I'll get to it. I just have to make this one last thought. Dude, Rondé Barber, the way he plays, dude, I mean, I know it's heavy to say something like this, but SMB reminds me a lot of Rondé Barber. Just – There's stuff there, man.
The Rook's got some of that in him. Antoine Winfield.
Yeah, I know. But, I mean, right now, from what I've seen in a Buck uniform at the NFL level, SMB's got some of that, man. He's got, like, that He's got it, man. If he can get the – like, if he can really study film, I see another Rondé Barber-esque type of player, bro.
Barber said that himself, actually, about Sean.
No joke. No joke. I mean, that pick he had, that pick six he had in Detroit, that was Rondé-esque. Mm-hmm. The way he read and baited the quarterback as a rookie, come on. That was good, man.
I see more of Rondé in SMB than I see Antoine Winfield. Antoine Winfield's – Rondé was never the greatest athlete, right? He was – he beat you here.
Yeah.
Antoine Winfield is a fucking – he's an athlete. He's a Swiss Army.
Yeah, he seems to have it all, doesn't he?
He reminds me of Honey Badger, you know.
Yeah.
That type of athlete. Rondé was not that kind of guy. Rondé had to beat you with his brain. You know what I mean? With he out-studied you and just out-thought you like SMB. SMB is more a little bit more of an athlete and a little bit faster, but he reminds me more of Rondé than Antoine Winfield.
Just go back and watch those games. You like I'm watching. I'm like, damn, dude, he looks a lot like SMB out there. And yeah, I don't like to put like these comparisons on players, especially when they're young, because I'm with like Stank. I don't want that juju, that weird energy out there. But I mean, it's that's just what I saw, man. But what's Devin his White. Wager, man? What's
Devin
his
White.
Wager?
Ray Lewis, Ray Lewis, Devin White, done.
Oh yeah,
or Patrick Willis.
I see that. Okay. I see Patrick Willis. Honestly, I see Patrick Willis.
You said it's going to be more of a 50-50 split. Right?
The wager?
50-50 split on the run pass.
Mm. I was saying 50-50 split in terms of them toning it back. I think they will
tone it back
a little bit in the second half.
I thought you meant 50-50 run pass.
I mean, I honestly do think that they'll be balanced, yeah. I think they're going to run a lot of 12. And when they run a lot of 12, they're going to be able to get more running lanes. They'll run out of it. They'll have so many more options. I think they'll be balanced because I just from what we saw last year from BA, from Byron, they try to be balanced. I don't know if not having a running game kind of messes that up. I just feel like they're going to have a better running game this year just because they have a little bit more up front.
I don't see us running a lot of 12. I don't think we're a power team.
What? They're going to run it. They're going to run it because it gets their guys on the field. It gives them all the options.
Yeah, but I just that we're not – we don't have an overpowering run.
They don't need it. They don't
blocking style of offensive line.
They don't need it. You put Gronk out there and you have the ability to run. You have OJ out there. You can pass to those guys. You legitimately can have four pass catchers out there, or you can run. And you'll have more guys than they can send right off the line of scrimmage at the snap. Dude, it's – and fucking Tom Brady was – is so good in 12, dude. It's so – it's they're going to run more 12. You have – there's no question. No question. It's going to happen. I don't care what you say.
Put your beard on the line.
My beard? My beard? Bitch, you're crazy. No.
When's the last time you've been bald-faced, Samer? The day you were born? Not even then.
When I was in seventh
grade. Not even then.
Seventh grade?
Mm-hmm. You had a stash in third grade, right? Like full-blown stash.
I had a full-on goatee when I was in eighth grade. Like the first day of school in eighth grade, I had a full-on goatee. I mean, I looked like fucking Horace Grant. Or not Horace Grant, Grant Hill. I had the Grant Hill goatee, bro. I remember that shit.
I mean, I used to get my ass beat because I used to use my mom razor, trying to shave to make the hair grow. The more you shave, they say, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I
didn't start growing facial hair until I was like in 10th grade.
I wanted it to connect. You know what I'm saying? It wouldn't connect.
Yeah, I had to do that. I had to do that in high school. I had to keep doing it to get this to connect and this here to get the soul patch going, all that stuff. But people aren't tuning in here to talk about my beard as much as I'd love to talk about it.
No, I think they might be, though.
Oh, I mean, okay, maybe. All right.
You don't know.
What questions you guys have?
What is your beard care remedy?
He doesn't even have a beard.
He does have a beard.
Look at the hang time. What the
f- I trim it, bro. I trim it. It's hot out here. I heard that the Rona can live in the beard, so I've just kind of been, you know, keeping it shorter.
Can the Rona live in the beard? You're fucked, Christian. If the Rona lives in the beard,
I'm dead.
It's in there.
Definitely a reason that my immune system, so like I just don't get sick. Coronavirus.
People, guys with beards and beautiful, you know, jawlines, you know, they tend to have very, very strong immune systems. I don't know anything about if that applies to the pinker tone people, but
there's a lot of racial undertones in this part. Like, I understand the world is at each other's throats right now. You know, people are beating women's asses in wheelchairs and spraying them with fucking fire extinguishers.
Look at the three it's of beautiful. Us. We're getting along just fine. You're pink. You're like tracing paper right. with fried grease on it.
All we're missing is X.
Spanish.
What did you say?
I'm brown. What? I'm Arab. I mean, I'm basically a terrorist anywhere I go where I'm outnumbered by the whites. I mean, we're all good.
Name a more diverse podcast than this. Name a more diverse podcast. Especially when you have X.
Podcast.
When you have X on here, we have the entire spectrum, the color wheel when X is here.
We got a full-on gradient. We go from white to black, shading gradient.
You call them a what? Tracing paper with grease on it? What?
You remember that?
Rewind that for a second.
That happened last podcast.
Unpack that.
I just did it again, though.
I never heard that. The tracing.
I'm going to buy you a custom jersey and just have it say tracing paper on the back.
By the way, shout out to my man X. We the loose cannons, baby. Yeah, bro, I want to thank y'all.
It's been a while. I need some X in my life.
Can y'all hear me?
Is this thing on? Hey, turn me up in my microphone.
We got to get X on here next episode, man. We have to. We have to.
Hey, I have no snare. I have no snare.
That's my brother.
Give more snare.
That's my brother. Listen, man. You know,
I need my ring light back.
We talked about that. The stadiums allowing fans, but listen, all four of us, we sit right next to each other, right? And if they do this thing where they're only going to allow 25% or 30% of the fans in,
not going to the game. Not going.
How is it going
to
work?
That's not going to be the case.
There's no way I could go and I don't have people next to me, especially people I want to have next to me. You know, that's not going to work, man. They've got to let everyone in or let no one in. It can't be in the middle.
Listen to me carefully, people. All you people out there. All you groovy people. I left what is the equivalent of San Diego, which means a whale's vagina, a vasection. To sit with these two guys because I love them.
Wait, you think you left a better section to move to? We're in the shade in seats that have cushion with bathrooms that have air conditioning.
And we have bidets.
It's not,
and we
have a bidet.
Not
bidets.
Confirmed shade yet. We're not confirmed yet.
No, bro, I sat there. No, Christian, Christian, I was in the East Club and the top half of that top like third is all shade, bro, the whole game.
Okay.
You don't even get rained on. I was there when it was that St. Louis game. You don't even get rained on.
It's still whale's vagina. I left the whale's vagina. The comfort of that warm, beautiful, cuddled up vagina just all up in there.
You'll never look – once that warm water hits your asshole out of that bidet, you'll never look back.
But the point is, left that section to sit with these guys because that's love. And if they tell
me
that it's only 25, well, the ass wash thing, I mean, I have
by warm mineral water.
I don't have mineral water. That does it make a difference?
It comes out of the bidet, bro. Comes out of the bidet.
Does the mineral water make a difference, though?
Oh, what does mineral water make it? Does Beck's baby oil make a fucking difference? What a stupid fucking question is that, man? Come on. Does Matt Gay make every fucking kick that matters when it actually matters?
Damn. You don't have to go in on me like that. I've never done the mineral water ass wash.
Sorry. Matt Gay, mineral water, Super Bowl. That's what's happening here, okay?
Thank you.
Let's bring these things back into perspective
here. I need to take you guys over I need to get you guys over to a Turkish bathhouse. The four of us.
Ooh. That sounds like
they'll send out a 12-year-old boy.
I like
boy.
The sound of that.
He'll wash our bodies.
Whoa. I was all about it. Then he said,
because that's what they do in Turkey. They like employ these young boys for some reason. Nope. It's non-sexual, bro. It's a fucking, it's like a massage.
What? I just looked at my calendar.
I have no openings.
Fully.
Corona
fully booked.
All closed.
Fully booked. Hey, Sammer, hit me on my DM though. But I'm fully booked. I'm fully booked.
No, don't get me on DM or anything. I'm out. Nope.
I already told you, bro. Only Korean women and Korean men can touch this body.
They know it's got to be Turkish. Outside of my wife. Bathhouse. Turkish bathhouses only employ Turkish family members. That's just how it works.
Here's the deal.
It's a family business surrounding asshole washing.
Let's wrap it up. Oh, Sammer froze. He froze on. He froze on ass washing.
Classic. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, that's how serious he takes this, okay? When he said 12-year-old bathhouse, the feds jumped on the Zoom call with the fucking quickness. He said 12-year-old boys washing my asshole, and they were like, we're done.
shut that shit down.
We are
down.
Stepping in. This podcast is officially.
What the fuck is going on with you? They've been quarantined too long.
I hate it so. Pause. It's still recording as well.
It is.
But you know what? We're going to keep the wheels moving, ladies and gentlemen.
Keep it going, ladies and gentlemen. So listen, what I was trying to say is I moved over there, and me and you agree, right? If they say 25% only and I don't get to sit with you guys, I'm just – like, I'll go. I have no problem going. It's my choice. I settle that. I'll go. Mm-hmm. But I want a packed house. If not, then I'll sell it to the fucking – I'll sell it to the fucking – the Brady guys that turned into – Bucks fans that want to go. I'm not.
2020 is the fucked up year.
Fuck 2020.
I'm going to say that I can't foresee that happening, but you never fucking know. Like this could, you know, we could all be relaxing and we shouldn't be. And the pandemic just goes crazy and we're back down in lockdown again at some point. I really don't know. I don't foresee that happening personally, but you just don't fucking know.
You see this? Look, they said if 2020 was a bus.
Yes, and we're all inside of that bus right there. Fucking careening down a street with no signs, no lights, and no end in sight. That's the most fucked up thing about this. We just don't know what the future holds.
How bad is 2020 though, bro? Legit. Like the Kobe shit, the Hornets, the killer Hornets, the stock market shit, the business is closing, coronavirus. All of this, it's just shit after shit after shit after shit after shit after shit. It's just bad.
Dude. It is. But, you know, you really need to take a step back at times. I force myself to do that. We live in this fucking chamber, this echo chamber, where all we're hearing is negativity all the time. You know, that's the thing I like about Twitter, because I can kind of finally craft my feed, and the shit that I don't want to see, I eliminate. So, I mean, there's so much bullshit going on in the world at all times. Like, I have zero politics on my feed. It's hard when shit like, you know, when terrible things happen, you're going to see it, you know, like
Minneapolis.
Yeah. Like what we're seeing in Minneapolis right now, which listen, I need to see that. We all need to see that. It's all a reminder to us what kind of fucked up people still exist on this planet. We know that. And, you know, nobody wants to talk politics. When they listen to this podcast, they want to hear us talk about the Bucks. But in reality, all these things have an effect on everything in our life and in the entertainment world. And that's what football is. It's entertainment. More than that for people like us. But, you know, it has a trickle-down effect. And in this world we're living right now, there is uncertainty. I will tell you this, if they leave it up to the fans, which ultimately I think is the right decision, and fans are reasonable, and you put some rules in place, like make sure that people are wearing at the very least face protection, have stations around the stadium where people can sanitize their hands. There's really not much more you can do. They want to take a thermal camera and take people's temperatures before they come in the stadium. Those are all reasonable steps. I think everybody would comply and that'll be the end of that. You know, other sports are going to fall in line before the NFL season officially starts. We've got another 2 months or so, right? Until preseason games, a little over 2 months.
Well, we got June, July, like mid-August for the first preseason game.
Right. So we've got, you know, fucking, you know, 70, 80 days before they really have to make any official decision on how they're going to handle it.
I think there's more than enough time, man. If they get through the preseason, let's say they get to the preseason, they say no fans. Mm-hmm. I think they can test it. And then by the time the regular season starts, I mean, look how much has happened in the last 2.5 months.
Yeah.
Like legit. How much has happened in the last 2.5 months? So who knows where the hell we'll be by September, which is 3 months away. Who knows? Legit.
It could go either way. That's the thing. It could easily slide back the other direction. But if you're the NFL, you have to take this approach. You can't say, oh, we're going to err on the side of caution. And then in August, you say, oh, nope, you know, everything's good. And we open the doors. Like you have to go in with the mindset that it's going to be business as usual. And then if it isn't at that point, you can make adjustments as necessary.
And you know, they're planning behind the scenes on that. So it's not like they're going to make a snap judgment like, oh, shit. They're saying business as usual and they're making contingency plans.
Yeah. And even what Greg Allman said on the podcast with me and Sammer a couple weeks ago. You know, I wasn't even aware that the schedule makers put in a contingency to be able to remove the early games into the, you know, towards the end of the season. Like, they can push those games back and it wouldn't affect how the schedule works. I don't know. But he made you know, an explanation that was a lot more clear than what I'm rambling on about right now. But it seems like they even thought about that before they released the official schedule. They can always push the Super Bowl back. Oddly enough, the Super Bowl is fucking here. We have Tom Brady, and this is the uncertainty we're going into the season with in this city. So it's gonna be fucking a wild ride, man. Just like everything else with our lives right now.
Listen, I've made an open invitation to Stank and Sammer. That, and I think we've all agreed, right? If they do this 25% shit, none of us are going. We're just going to sell our tickets, and we're gonna jump from house to house, week to week, each game.
Yeah.
The week that it's at my house, open invitation to all loose cannons. Fuck it. All loose cannons, flood my fucking house. Fuck it, let's go. I don't care.
Have you spoken to Angie about this?
I want to see Lou. I want to see fucking Breeze Overrated. I want to see Chef. I want to see Chef Boyard talk. Yeah, my boy.
Yes.
I want X.
X. All of them.
I'm going to fill my entire pool with Bex. I want to see Beck. Fuck it, man. Everybody come to my house. Crash. We're going to have a big-ass fucking loose cannons party. I have the projector up. Fuck it.
No matter what, we're all going to ride through this together. Like, this isn't going to stop us from being fans. We're still going to be, if we got to do it through the digital life like we've been doing for the last 3 months, you know, our draft parties get canceled. We still have a pretty fucking kick-ass draft party show. Man, we're going to make the best of it, and we're all going to share that experience with everybody. But, you know, yeah, it would suck major fucking dicks if we couldn't do that in the stadium. We all want to see, you know, the GOAT in a Bucks uniform, in person, on the field. It's got to happen. So I'm going to maintain my positive energy and my positive outlook until we get to that point. And we'll see what happens.
That's the way I feel. You know, and we had a long conversation earlier about this, and it's been a weird off season, right, guys? We all get into the dog days and fuck, there's nothing to talk about. I think that fucking 800-pound gorilla called coronavirus in the room that has had all of us nervous. What do you mean? I've had a lot of days where I'm like, fuck, are we gonna have a season? Like, it's been a concern, right? So any little crumb or any little bit of news that the NFL releases that it's moving forward gets me really happy. But the offseason, because of that, has kind of gone by kind of fast, right? Like, there's been no dog days. So I'm gonna, you know, even though it worries me, I'm gonna continue to be positive, and I'm excited as fuck, and I expect to see football in September.
We've been lucky,
fans in the stands.
I don't know that every other NFL city feels the same way we do. In this town, there's been so much to talk about. You know, we had months of wondering what was going to happen with Jameis. Then the ultimate bomb drops. We get Tom Brady. Gronk comes in. Draft's been here. You know, and now we're going to ride that high right into the season, no matter what. Jesus. We've had the beauty of being a Bucks fan right now is we've had the ultimate escape to throw our minds and our lives into to get us through this fucking awful, awful time. And by the way, congratulations. I know you and the Headlines crew are back in business. You know, barbers are out there making money. You know, I think a lot of other essential businesses and maybe even not the non-essential ones are starting to find their way back. There's still a lot of people who aren't in, you know, are out of work right now. I know my girl Michelle, who listens to all these podcasts, is still out there fighting the good fight for people trying to get assistance for being unemployed right now and all that shit. Oh, Mr. Ali!
I'm back. You guys did pretty well without me, man, without any supervision. I was proud of you.
Listen, I was hoping you weren't going to come back, so you could leave on the mic drop that you left this on.
Prince Ali, fabulous.
All right. When you go back and watch this, when you go back and watch this and you see how you exited the show, it's
12-year-old boy.
No, you know, a fucking A script writer couldn't have written it any better or any worse for you.
Thank God you're back. Well, this is going down a dark place. We were going dark, man. It was just.
No, I don't think we were.
No, we're just being real. So. We're being real.
I think you guys just don't know what I'm referring to because in Turkey, like those Turkish bathhouses. Right next
to it. Like the feds shut you down.
And yeah, we were sure that ICE had moved in on you with ICE, the quickness. Yeah.
Now, listen, man, when you pay certain people, when you pay certain people certain money, you're afforded the luxury of getting away with certain words. That's all. There are still words I can't say. They're on the red list.
Jeffrey Epstein.
Jeffrey Epstein.
Wow, really, bro? Really? You going to go down? No, that's messed up, man.
Paid people off.
No. I was going to let you, like, pimp out the Tomb 45 brand just now, but I'm changing my mind. Changing my mind.
Trust me, I'm not being cocky here. I don't need to pimp the 245.
Wow.
We're fine.
We're that's a Samer mic drop. Boom.
Listen. Boom. Isn't Bex Baby Oil and Tomb 45 in direct competition?
Absolutely not. They don't make a – actually, they're in collaboration. We're having contract talks, discussions right now.
Notice about how rolling out. Green. Tomb 45 green, too. I'm like, okay. Okay.
That we did it on purpose. So it fits on the shelf next to your stuff, bro. It's together. It's a collab. Yeah,
it's going to look good on the Headlines Barbershop's shelves.
Well, it's going to look good on the bus. He knew we were going to take the bus to a tailgate, so he's like, it's got to match the bus.
Bro, I couldn't comment because I turned my microphone off so I could fix what was going on with my camera, but you said that your pool was going to be filled with Beck's baby oil. Bro, I got so excited. I wanted to jump on, but now, oh my God, I'm there. I'm absolutely there. We're getting as many loose cannons as possible to fill that fucking baby oil pool up, baby. I can't wait.
I can't wait, bro. Loose cannons fans, 12-year-old Turkish kids. It's a fucking party, bro. It's a fucking party.
Can't wait.
My house. No 12-year-old kids rubbing, cleaning assholes at my house.
Hey, no Spanish children, but as many little Turkish boys as you want.
No Spanish kids allowed. Hey, you're going to get rid of your kids on that day, right?
By the way,
you're going to get rid of them.
Rid of them?
That's what he said. You're going to get rid of your kids on that day.
What is wrong with you?
No Spanish kids. It's a rule. It's a fucking t-shirt.
Your kids can come, but my kids got to go? Your kids are supposed to come. What are you talking about? I said bring the wife and the kids, pool party. The kids, they can play in the pool. We can exchange.
Yeah, but
there's going to be a lot of baby oil. There's going to be a lot of baby oil. I just don't feel like it's an environment for kids who are not Turkish bathhouse employees.
Oh, this is before the season, dude. This is like now, the three of us.
What's the wager? What's the wager with our wings, bro?
Shave your beard.
Oh, no.
Lose who shaves his beard. You believe in your shit that much. No. I have a lot more to lose than you.
Nah, man. No way. I have no way. No.
He's not that confident as well.
Let the fans decide. Stank, what do you think? Let's put a poll up.
No, I'm not shaving my beard. I don't care. No way I'm getting rid of my beard. Y'all
vote on the poll. Stank's about the poll because I don't know how to do it. Let the fans decide. My wings versus his wings. Loser has to shave his beard. If you guys want to see that, vote.
I
want
to see Samer. He has to grow his beard for a year. Not trimmed. Nothing. It's full out growth. No, dude, he can't
I
edge
look
it
like
up.
Christian. I look like Christian in a week. If I don't trim, I look like Christian in a week. Imagine a fucking year.
You can't trim your unibrow. You can't none of that. Just you got to let all your facial hair grow wild.
Wow.
It's from my nose down, bro. And my ears, too. But
so if you'd be like me in a week, what are you worried about shaving your beard? If your wings are better than mine, what are you worried about? It'll grow back in 2 days.
I didn't say – listen, I don't know if I'm going to say – if I'm confident enough to say my wings are better than yours. You have a lot of years on me with this wing stuff. I just know mine are fucking good. Like real fucking good. I haven't even had yours before.
I like how nobody's even considering the actual veteran in the chat right now in this conversation.
With chicken wings?
But I'm entering my wife's wings. But I listen, if no, I actually
– how does that even count then?
Your wings.
Because they're my wings.
No.
They're my family wings.
No, they're not. They're Sasha's wings.
Yeah, they're from her family.
Technically
they're not
mine.
If you would like to get her recipe, that's fine. But we have to cook them from scratch.
I can do it. I know exactly what – I will introduce –
You don't look like you know how – you don't look like you know how to do much in the kitchen, honestly. You just don't look it.
No, wait.
You know what's funny? I do the cooking in my relationship. I am the chef. I make some good –
ramen.
I cook.
And macaroni and cheese. You look like a macaroni and cheese dad.
I make $100 macaroni and cheese.
Oh, you do baked macaroni and cheese, bro?
I do $100 macaroni and cheese.
You probably put raisins in your fucking potato salad.
Raisins in my...
Yeah, you look like that guy. First of all,
I don't
look at the guy that shows up to the cookout with raisins in his potato salad with no fucking spices, no seasonings.
I don't eat potato salad. I
put carrots in that bitch.
No paprika.
I don't eat potato salad.
Oh, wait. I'm about
to drop. Oh, yeah. You're the only white guy who doesn't like mayo.
He's a Miracle Whip guy.
I don't like anything that's even related to mayo. Unless it's that sweet mayonnaise that's on sushi, I can deal with that.
You eat Miracle Whip?
I don't eat. I don't even have a jar of mayonnaise in my house. That's I hate mayonnaise. When I make tuna, I use mustard and hot sauce. Okay.
So tell me you're going to put this poll up, Stank, because the people got to vote.
Okay.
No, they don't.
My wings are the same as wings. If you want to see it go down,
I'm not shaving my beard.
Who has to shave his beard? Sam or Scare?
I'll pay money. I'm not shaving my beard. I'll shave Stank's beard if I lose.
Bro, I've shaved my beard once every couple weeks.
I have to do it myself. With
you want to shave my beard?
I want to shave your beard.
Fine, bro.
I'm going to take your fucking manhood, bro.
Look how thin my shit comes in. Like I'm a cancer patient, bro.
It just looks like a 3-year-old scribbled on your face.
I don't have the thickest of hair. Everything else on me is thick as fucking a chocolate shake with extra ice, bro.
You guys want to talk about being nervous with Madden and when we did the schedule show? I was listening to Real Bucks Talk. Shout out to them. I like their show. And they did a schedule break.
Yes. Michael Pless, what's up?
They do a good job.
They had us 8-1.
I told you, bro. I told you. I didn't see two losses. More than two losses.
I feel like Tina Turner. Like I feel like a beaten. Like I just no.
They're gonna lose two games. They're gonna lose in Denver because it's just a Denver all out like all of that stuff. Denver's altitude, the all one? That shit.
Denver's not.
And they're gonna lose in Vegas because it's Vegas. It's John Gruden versus Tom Brady. First time he's faced him, I think, since the Tuck rule. And
yeah, you know,
also, it'll be the first time he's faced the Bucks since the Bucks fired him.
You know,
no, he hasn't coached against Tom Brady.
We're not going undefeated in the NFC South.
Do you
know that happening?
Who else he plays? Who else plays against Tom Brady? Not John Gruden.
Aaron Rodgers.
Also, Derek Carr.
It's not about that. I just
when I look at matchups, I look at the quarterbacks. Okay.
I know, but I just feel like it's just one of those games that they're just gonna drop. Maybe they overestimate the opponent. Whatever it is, I think they're gonna lose that game. That's all.
Underestimating the opponent.
Chief. Underestimate. Sorry. What did I say? Overestimate.
I said overestimating. Chief. Yikes.
Talking like a Spanish guy.
Whoa. Okay. Listen. We're gonna end this podcast the only way we know how.
Wow.
Oh no.
Fire the fucking cannons.
No, it's ready. The fucking cannons. You guys are ruining it. Thank you for tuning in, those of you who have somehow made it this far in the
podcast.
Wait,
it's over? It's over?
We're done?
We're done?
I thought you guys wanted to end it.
No, we're not.
That's what wifey said. Wait, it's over?
It's right. It's over.
That's it?
Sasha. Seven seconds?
Sasha's
7 seconds?
Damn, bro, I said wifey. You're going to say her government name? What the fuck is wrong?
Samra's wife definitely doesn't say that because she's not allowed to talk.
She's not?
No.
Don't speak talk to me.
Don't speak.
Don't make eye contact with me when I am.
Listen, Samra's like, I will moan my own name. I don't want to hear any noise out of you. The entire.
Listen, you guys. Listen, hold on. Let's talk about this.
That's right. I don't want to hear you. I don't hear a peep out of you.
I prefer my own voice. Yes, you're correct.
Exactly.
You know what I do? I record these podcasts in separate audio tracks, and I mute you guys, and I just play my track when I listen to the replay.
When
it's
Samer
just me talking.
When Samer gets busy,
of silence.
When Samer gets busy, his voice gets very low. He goes back to his roots.
My roots come out. Yeah,
you're right. That's right. Listen,
that's the voice I give the target manager when something's not right. They get roots Samer voice. They don't want
Real talk. Would you be in there looting Target if you had the opportunity? Just to say you looted, you were there to do it.
No, man. I didn't. Like,
I don't
you
need
guys are
anything.
Talking about this. You guys talked about this when I was not on here, but like, dude, I, you know, I agree with Stank in the sense that, like, we don't want to get political and, you know, that, but that stuff's life, man. That shit is life. And I don't know how much Stank can relate to some of this stuff, but I know for one, like, I'm not African American, I'm Arab American, but I've been through some shit as it relates to just being judged on my appearance and things of that nature. And is it as bad as maybe, you know, what African Americans face in like the Malcolm X times and Martin Luther King and even beyond that? No, it's not, but it's still not American. It's still not correct. And all that shit is part of life, man. Like, so to not bring it up while it's happening on a show like this, I understand not wanting to, but it's around us, man. It affects us. It's like, you know, I'm one of those people that considers everybody my brother or sister or whatever gender you want to go by, like all of that stuff. So to see the shit that happened, man, that's fucked up, man. And to like see that other, you know, police officers of different race, if they accidentally do something similar, they're immediately, you know, sentenced to 12 and a half years, 20 years. And these guys are chilling at their house, you know, and there's people who listen to us who probably don't agree, but you know, you can't tell me how to feel, you know?
Yeah, no, I have zero tolerance for that kind of shit. So you know, I might have been born in the South, but my people weren't. So I don't play those games, man. That kind of shit right there. It gets me emotional. It really does. I mean, I think it does to everybody. And I don't really want to even share my opinion because there's a lot better, more, you know, again, people have lived through shit I've never experienced. So my opinion isn't important right now. It just isn't. And so I'd rather not even go there because I'm not here to convince anybody, you know, of how they should feel. Because like you said, I cannot relate on that level. I have been racially profiled before. I got put in the back of a cop car because they thought I was buying crack.
I don't know if that's racial, but
I was white in a black area. I got put in the back of a cop car because they thought I was.
They literally told them that crack. You're white in the hood. We thought you were buying crack. Oh. So we
yes, yeah. Doesn't matter though. I mean, that's nothing compared to any of these stories.
No, but and the thing is, what's encompassing about all of it is that, like, sports is like the one area that I feel like none of that shit matters. Like, you know, I ran into X at a training camp takeover. X is like my brother now. I don't see anything color wise. Christian, you, like, all that stuff. The players on the field, like, they're in the locker rooms. They're fighting the same war. They're, you know, on the same battlefield. Race doesn't seem to matter. Like, none of that shit exists. And it's very rare that you hear a story that anything racial tension-wise happens in a locker room or on a sporting field or in a fan group or, you know, a fan base. None of that stuff happens because there's, like, this other collective focus that takes away from all that stuff. How that doesn't seem to be working outside of that, I don't know, man. It's just – it's mind-boggling to me that what happened in Minnesota can still happen. Like, how? It's 2020. How is that happening?
I don't know about you, but I ran into Stank at training camp, and it wasn't so much of a brotherhood thing. I just said, wow, you're Stank? You are hot as fuck. Can I have your number? And then it just kind of – it blossomed from there.
That's I met him because he was over my shoulder at a training camp takeover outside. He was over my shoulder yelling into my ear. I said, this fucking guy, just – he's killing me.
Sounds like intern Betty.
Yes. Yeah.
Sam, I bought a t-shirt from you. Where the fuck is it?
Where the fuck is the t-shirt, Sam?
But on the video for me, I'm not going to go way into my opinion again, because even though it is part of life and all of that, I just choose not to. But if you saw that video and saw what took place and have no emotion, like, I don't know how you get through that and not feel, you know, I can't quantify it. I can't quite put it into words, but I couldn't get through it. If that puts perspective to it.
If you sided with the police officer, you need to look in the mirror.
It was a live, it was a live Because look, we've seen a lot of these videos. We've seen a lot of these leaks. We've seen all this stuff. But that was like all the way. You know what I mean? It was a live execution. I literally saw somebody get executed. It was, that's too heavy for me, man. And like Samer said, in 2020, man, like what are we doing here? What are we talking about right now? Like, it's 2020. Like, I've been profiled. I'm Spanish. I grew up in a fucking redneck hills. Nowhere near the oppression and the situation that our brothers have gone through. And I can't imagine, like, I have a son. I can't imagine raising my son and having that in the back of my mind that the next interaction, and every interaction with cops may be good, but the next one could be his last. It's just, again, what are we talking about right now? What is this?
I don't know. I mean,
a parent, you get, like, I'm afraid to send my kid to school. Imagine being afraid to send your kid to school because of bullies and shit like that. But on top of that, serve and protect, and yeah. Like, what?
The chance that they'll just have something horrible happen to them simply because they're not the same color as the person they ran into. That, yeah. You know.
That's, yeah, you would think that level of ignorance in this day and age with all the information available, it just wouldn't be a thing. But unfortunately, and if you look at this fucking dude's track record, he's got a history. I don't know if you saw what Beck retweeted. Yeah, 13 complaints. He's been involved in other murders. And that guy is let to be out there with a weapon. I mean, it's disgusting. It's disgusting, man. And you know what? To bring it back to football, you know, the sport that we love, all the sports we love, we're all big sports fans outside of football. Sam, I think you're a huge NBA fan. I love all sports in general. It directly has a huge impact on that world, especially in football, because the majority of players in the NFL are African American.
I mean, you're talking about the NBA too, man. NBA
in the NBA, it's even exactly even more. So, like,
healing is over. It's just about to get started.
Man, it's you know, like something like that happens in broad daylight. Other cops are there. It wasn't like one of those things that happens in, like, you know, the back of a trap house, or, you know, he said she, like, this is like right there
with a crowd around you telling you
people who screaming. Could have stopped him. And I'm not talking about the people who are watching, because, you know, those people are not going to go run at a cop, especially with other cops around. Like, that's not going to happen. But the other cops just standing there like, dude, how does that happen? How does that happen? How were those guys just standing there? Like I see something happen that's incorrect or wrong. Like, there's a moral, like, compass that, like, tugs at you. And even if you know something bad's happening, you know, like when you're in high school or something, you know, with your boys, you still, like, that tug pulls you and you're like, fuck, I got to stop this. You know, if you're beating up a kid or something stupid like that, this happens. Like, those guys who are supposed to uphold these moral, like,
serve and protect,
like, all of that stuff that goes into it. And those guys don't have that compass, that tug, that little Jiminy Cricket yelling in their ear, like, hey, this ain't fucking right. Let's fucking stop it. Like, that doesn't happen.
And
how's that even a thing? Like, look, the closest thing that I can't relate to what African-Americans go through. Definitely can't relate to what they went through over the years in America. The closest I can say, experience-wise, is like a post 9/11 America being an Arab American. Like, that is the closest thing I have to relate to it. And you know, I'm not gonna act like I can be in their shoes, but that shit wasn't easy, man. Like, that shit just wasn't easy. Like, I mean, I still to this day, my mom wears a headscarf as a Muslim. I go to the gas station and fill up my mom's car every week, because when my mom goes to a gas station, more often than not, she's verbally assaulted. She's like all sort of profanities, racial shit just thrown at my mom for no fucking reason. And by people who, I mean, my family collectively, we're more educated than any of these people, like, combined. My mom is educated, like, all that stuff and the stuff that she has to hear. I have to go and fill up gas in 2020 for my mom at the gas station, because I fear that one day, if she goes, she's not going to come back, simply because of what she chooses to wear and the religion she practices. Now, think about that if I was African-American. Like, I can't even – like, you're not even doing anything wrong. You're not even pushing someone's buttons. You're not instigating it. You're just being you. And that – like, how the fuck, man? Like, that shit's
– yeah. And right there, that is the definition. Opinion. It's the definition of the privilege I have. Because I that thought doesn't cross my mind when my father or my mother, who rest in peace, goes to the gas station or is in an area town. I never grew up having to worry about that. So when people talk about the privilege of not having to live in fear, I get that. I get that because I've had that privilege. I don't fear for my life in that way. And it sickens me that so many fucking people do, you know? So when you hear people who have of color go through that struggle, that's what that really means, you know? And it's, I get it. Most people don't have that malice in their heart. I'd say the majority of people don't feel that way, would never treat somebody that way, but we've got to hold others accountable for their actions. You know, all the shit I've heard and let slide in my life because I'm a non-confrontational person, I carry that with me. You know what I mean? That I feel guilty for it. Not that I would ever participate in that, but we all know what's out there. Shit, I was in fucking Homosassa over the weekend on the river. You know how many fucking outwardly brazen racial motherfuckers are out there? They're there. It's all around me all the time. You know, so and I'm assuming you live in Florida, you see it as well. Chris, you live in Pasco County, you see it, you hear it.
All you gotta do is drive down I-4.
Yeah.
And you see
the exactly. So
with the giant rebel flag.
I apologize to those who didn't tune in for this, but you know, we've said this from the beginning. This podcast is a form of therapy to us. And when real life shit is happening, we're gonna talk about it.
And bringing it back to football. Good for the University of Minnesota. Did you guys see that?
Fuck yeah. Hell yeah.
Good for the University of Minnesota because they realized that it's not a single officer problem, right? It's an institutional problem. You were talking about the guy's rap sheet. I mean, it went on for – it was fucking ridiculous, bro. 13 filed complaints, involved in, like, 4 murders. I don't know how many assaults. Like, you know, at some point – where the fuck is Minnesota's police department going to hold that guy accountable? So if you guys don't know what we're talking about, the University of Minnesota said, we don't want anything to do with MPD. Like, we don't want you on our campus. We don't want you at our games. We don't want you anywhere near. We are just cutting ties 100%.
And it's MPD. It's not a small thing to do that because if they're gonna, now when they go to get security in their school, they're paying more. They're paying more for private form of security that's not, you know, bringing in the local police department anymore. Like that move is way bigger than people think, man. And
statement,
you know, like they're not that department could have held that guy accountable years ago. They haven't. So there's nothing that says they will hold this guy accountable. The only thing that will maybe force their hand is public opinion and pressure. At that point, it doesn't matter. Like they're not doing it for the right reasons. Like
He's still not arrested. That shit was business as usual. How many times when the camera wasn't rolling have these motherfuckers gotten away with this kind of shit? And how many times across history? I mean, we live in the time now where everybody carries a high definition camera in their pocket in their hand, and we're now able to document all these atrocities that people have been screaming at the top of their lungs that have been happening around them, and they see them and their kids see them, and that shit is in their community on a consistent basis. Now we're documenting that shit, and it needs to be seen. It's disgusting. It hurts, but it needs to be on my mind. I'm glad it's on my mind. I'm glad it's on everybody's mind, you know? So
it sucks, man, because like when I was a kid, you know, you grow up and you're full of hope and positivity, and you're like, no, dad,
innocent,
this is not how things work. They teach us in school this, this and that. No, everyone does. No one sees that kind of stuff, right? You get older and you're like, you get wiser and you're like, this shit still happens. You got to be a little bit smart about certain things. You can't say certain things, can't do certain things here and there. You know, you just, you think things out. And then now I have kids, you guys have kids, like How do you explain that kind of shit to kids? Like, kids don't see that stuff unless they're taught to see that stuff. And then when they
do, you explain it to them. That's how you do
like,
it.
Like, it's
you
just don't different. That, like, that yeah. sucks that in 2020, I have to explain that kind of shit to my kids.
It does.
If they ask. Like, that's not, like, that ain't comfortable, but it shouldn't be a thing. It shouldn't be a reality. Like,
you're doing yourself a disservice if you're not honest with your children about that kind of shit.
Really. You have no choice but to be honest. That's my point.
Yeah.
You have to kind of
strip because they're going to be a little exposed
bit of innocence. You have to strip away a little bit of innocence for your kids in a way that you don't want to, but you have no choice because of other people's actions.
The second they put their headphones on and they go and try to play Call of Duty online, they're going to hear all these little fucking pieces of shit using the N-word left and right. Like, everybody's heard that shit. If you've ever played a game online, you hear these idiots yell it out like it's nothing. You know what I mean? Like, your kids are going to be exposed to it very early on. And if you don't give them the tools to understand what word, not just that word, what those types of things, the weight they carry, you're doing them a disservice. So,
and you know, having kids involved in sports, man, like youth sports, that, you know, it sounds cliche, like, but dude, you put the melting pot of kids in that locker room or on a team and collective effort towards one goal, like that shit erases some of that stuff because, like I said earlier, the sporting field, the field of play, is such a leveled field in terms of you don't see that stuff.
It doesn't exist. Yeah, it really doesn't exist in sports, like not like that, because when you bleed and sweat and fight with your brothers out there, you know, not that. If maybe you didn't realize, maybe you come from an environment where you had no control of the messages you heard and you grew up with ignorant people and they beat you down with that shit at a young age, you know, but sports is the equalizer. You leave that space and you move into a room where the people of every color exist and you go through those battles and you realize that shit's a fake. It's a facade. It's ignorance. And it melts away. That's the beauty of sports, because it really doesn't exist on that level.
It's the ultimate equalizer. But
it is.
You said a comment earlier about stripping innocence, and I'm guilty of that, Sammer. I'm guilty of that, Stank. My kids are still young, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's rough for me to have that conversation with my 9-year-old, you know what I mean?
It is.
My kids were quarantined up with my wife. My wife, obviously, she's a stylist, so she was home the entire time. I had to leave home because of 2:45 and because of UPS. But my kids were home the entire time. And, you know, I don't use profanity in front of my kids. We don't do the news thing in front of my kids. So they had kind of no idea what was going on. And the first time they had to leave the house, man, and now I'm getting really open with you guys, right? I wouldn't say it broke me, but it hurt, because my son is like me. He wears his heart on his sleeve, right? I'm a big ass dude. I'm just a big fucking teddy bear. And to see my son, who's like me, who wears his heart on his sleeve, literally shocked and in fear and, you know, emotional a little bit. What's wrong with all these people? Why are they wearing masks? Mm-hmm. That's the type of stuff that scares me to have a conversation with my son on this subject. It's rough. You're right. You're 1,000% right. You have to expose your kids to it, and you have to explain it to them because you're doing them an injustice. But fuck, dude, to strip away innocence.
Yeah, if you don't do it, the world's going to do it for you. So you better prepare them.
Yeah.
Because they're friends. You know, they're not like us, man. We, like, our innocence at least lasted until we were, I don't know, 10, 12. Like, nowadays with phones and social media and shit like that, like, innocence doesn't exist. These kids are exposed to all of it really early on and in 100% fucking HD. It's right there in front of them. And they're, you know, my daughter's 14, about to be 15. You know, like, she's constantly tied in to this network of friends, and just like a lot of people are, you know, there's no escaping what's out there with reality, with violence and sex and guns and just everything that goes on in this world, you know, and we do talk about it a lot, you know, so.
And nothing's changed in the sense that kids are fucking cruel. If not, they're more cruel now. It's
oh, yeah.
They have the ability to reach out and touch you at any time. Right.
He can hide behind a keyboard.
My son came home. My son came home before school was over, right? Crying because they were making fun of him because he likes to sing. I said, man, you know what? I didn't say fuck them, but essentially I said fuck them. Like, you know what? You think Ed Sheeran didn't get made fun of, or you think, you know, this guy didn't get made fun of? Forget what they think. But it's insane how cruel fucking kids are, bro. Because he's talented at something and he's really good at it. Let's make fun of him.
They have the, yeah. There's nothing that stops them from doing it. That's why they can hide behind a keyboard. It's all that stuff, you know? I mean, like, we would bully each other when we were kids, right? There was some, like, razzing that happened and shit like that, but it was face-to-face.
You had to disconnect.
Yeah, when you went home, that shit didn't follow you. Now it follows you. So, yeah, there's a lot of instances that you don't have a choice. Like, you got to strip it away slowly. The only thing you can do is control how, like, quickly it goes off, you know?
Yeah, whatever. I mean, back to what we're talking about. Like, I don't know necessarily. I mean, obviously, you got young kids, and maybe they're not able to wrap their mind around what they're seeing. But you know, if they're of a certain age where you feel like they're able to handle it, it's you got to expose them to this imagery. I think they need to know what's going on in the world out there, so they know how to handle it in real life. Because like again, if you don't show it to them, their friends will, or they'll see it. You know, on fucking Snapchat or TikTok or whatever the fuck they look at, it's gonna make it its way into their minds unless you really isolate them from it. Which, don't get me started with that. I don't think that's healthy either. So, to circle back to what got us started here, man. You know, sometimes you just got to get shit off your chest, man. You know, that's just the way it is, and. This is a tough time. I think we're all feeling it right now in so many fucking ways. Jesus. So many ways.
Sports makes a lot of that stuff go away in the sense that, like, it erases. Not erases it, but you don't see it, you know? You see guys fighting and it just, you know, it helps. There's no sports happening right now, you know?
What do you mean? Did you not see Tom Brady playing golf?
Yeah, we saw it. But
I saw his pants social distancing.
His ass cheeks. Separated.
I did see the shot live though, and I.
So did I.
I screamed like a fucking
I saw live. Girl.
I had just tweeted out that Tom Brady's fucking personality annoys the shit out of me, and
I said,
He hits the shot. Yes, real life Karen came out of me. What? It's in my DNA. I'm sorry,
dude.
Plus the Jewish side of me. We like to complain. We're complainers. So, anyways.
Like a schoolgirl.
He's right. 5 minutes later, or if that even, he dunks that fucking shot. And you saw that competitor. You saw the lion, bro. You saw that shit come out. He told Charles Barkley, fuck you, live on television, basically, without saying that. Basically,
dude, they went on a roll.
They went on Charles.
They went on a roll, too. And you're like, holy shit, man. Like, the fire. Like, I know he's not playing football and he's playing golf and it's not a sport, but man, he's like, he's Jordan in a sense. Like, he's, Jordan was going to keep playing cards until he won. Yep. He was going to keep playing, you know, spades until he won. He wasn't going to stop and he was going to keep shooting the threes and challenging you until he finally won. Yep. And you saw that fire out of Tom Brady and that's fucking good. Like, oh man, this guy's 42, but he still got it.
He was quiet and uncomfortable. He wasn't saying shit. Manning was talking. Tiger was talking. They were all talking. Right. You could see it was eating him alive that he was hitting shots into the fucking weeds and shit. And then when he hit that, bro, the real Tom came out, bro. It was a beautiful thing. My first time we're like actually witnessing something like that, dude, with him.
I thought he was going to hit us with the LFG.
Fucking go.
Dude, imagine when that hits, like, rubs off on all the other guys. Guys like maybe Levante, who show their fire on the field but not necessarily verbalize it as much. You know, they're more like a Derrick Brooks kind of guy. Some of that's going to come out. Mike Evans, Vita Vea, dude, guys like that. That guys are just going to have to – they're going to feed off of that. Just like, you know, people always say, like, teams take on their personality of their coaches. Well, Tom Brady has a way of, you know, forcing his personality upon the rest of the team because he's almost like a coach. He's going to be a coach on the field in a sense. So his guys have no choice but to take on his personality or who's going to get in their face. And that's exciting because there's some guys that could really fucking use it. If OJ could get some of that fire, bro.
You know who has that intensity? And is going to be – that's going to be his dog, bro. 13. Like, 13 has that, bro. Like, 13 has that kind of
Yeah, he hates to lose.
You could tell Evans didn't like to win. He hated to lose. He hates.
Care less. And he was happy as hell in the Rams game where Godwin went off. He doesn't give like it's not oh we won lose, doesn't get my shit. He just wants to fucking win. Period.
That the biggest problem right there, the biggest problem the Bucs have had for years, man, has always been like they have all these guys that love to win, and I've said it. I've been saying it for like 6 years. But they don't have enough guys that hate to lose. Jameis, for you know all of his shortcomings, motherfucker hated to lose, bro, and that shit's contagious. Like he hated to lose. You could tell he didn't love winning. He hated to lose. He couldn't have his own way at times, but he still hated losing. Gerald McCoy loved to win.
It starts on the practice field though, but you know Brady's going to bring that. Like he's not. If they have a bad practice, it's going to eat his ass up, and then he's going to eat their asses up in the locker room and in the film study.
Brady eats
he's just not going
to
accept anything of shit other like than
you for breakfast.
Right. Listen, the do your job shit, we see where that started at with now, right? That wasn't a Patriots thing. That was a Michael Jordan thing. That do your job shit started with that type of that type of intensity, that refusing to be, you know, refusing to lose. And I'm not just talking about losing a game. I'm talking about refusing not to be a champion, you know, and we said it from the beginning. Brady brings that mentality into this locker room, and you're not. It's either you're on board or you're not. Like no, you can't afford not to be a part of that, or else you won't be a part of this team for very long. So, I'm looking forward to seeing that energy have a ripple effect throughout the 53.
It's going to. There's no doubt it's going to. Whether it has the same effect as like, you know, him in his prime. You know, I don't know. It'll have enough of an effect to make it a big difference because that, like that's real stuff, man. That's real energy that you bring to a team, and it's the most exciting part of Brady, to be honest. I mean, I see him. He's declined over the years. No, there's no doubt. And can he still play at a level that is a championship level? Absolutely. Yeah. But that energy that he brings is the most exciting part, and I think that's what Mike Evans was saying when he said that. He instantly changes the franchise. It's that. It's not his arm that's going to change the franchise. It's not his, you know, defensive, you know, cues and reading the defense and understanding, you know, when to audible. That's not going to change the franchise. His mindset, his approach, his energy and his fucking attitude is going to change the franchise. And if it doesn't, like, he's going to make it change. You don't have a choice. You don't have a choice.
Well, That's the point that I made when I was so excited about Brady being signed, was I compared it to Hardy. It's that kind of ripple effect because everyone's like, well, he's only going to be here for 2 years. Well, Hardy left an imprint on this team in the short time that he was here that carried us through that whole 10-year run on defense. So
there wouldn't be any Derek Brooks without Hardy.
Exactly. Or Rondé or Lynch or any of those guys. So I hope – and I think that that's the kind of imprint he's going to leave. But you talked about Jameis and about hating to lose more than he loved to win, right? And I fully believe that Jameis had that. The problem was Jameis didn't have maybe his first 2 years because of the Heisman and the national championship. He had the gravitas and the wow. But eventually that kind of – it started to fall on deaf ears. And it was a different Jameis. Me and you have had that talk, Adam. I remember Jameis standing at the podium at the end of the Panthers game and saying, some of these coaches in this fucking room care more about winning than some of the guys in the locker room that needs to change. You remember him pounding the podium with that?
Yeah.
That wasn't the same Jameis that left here. After a while, man, I think he just got beat. And I hate to say that because I like Jameis, but you reach a level where you just feel defeated. And they failed him as an organization. And I talk shit. But they failed them. You know what I mean? And it reached a point where, he hates to lose, but it's like, what else can I fucking do?
I think a lot of what hurt Jameis, man, he couldn't get out of his own way, true. But I think what ultimately defeated that energy that we saw from him, that young kid that came in with, you know, the world is at my feet, at my fingertips, I'm going to take over, is that playing in his own home stadium, he still felt the pressure of having to prove himself to the people who hated him just because he was a Florida State Seminole. I think that played a big factor, like having to constantly come in. He had more pressure at home than he did on the road.
His off-field stuff didn't help either.
No, I'm not discounting that stuff. I'm just saying there was it seemed like an added pressure. He pressed more at home in front of home fans to try to win over those people as opposed to how he played on the road. Like, have you ever seen a young quarterback who played better on the road than at home? I mean, his home record
was worse. He threw more picks at home.
And I sincerely thought it was because he pressed so hard to try to win over some of those critics who he knew were in Tampa more than anywhere else. And it, you know, losing fucks you up, man. It beats you down. Like, we've seen time and time again, like, quarterbacks that come in, Heisman Trophy winners, you can't win because you get drafted by a shit organization. It beats you down. Very rarely do they recover. Like Joe Burrow. I mean, what's going to happen to that kid? He's going to the Bengals, man.
Joe Burrow's going to be rookie of the year, and he's going to be the goddamn next GOAT.
Yeah, I mean, college success versus NFL success, I mean, we all know the margin for error in the pros is so much smaller. You got nothing but freak athletes all around you all the time. So,
you're getting drafted by a shitty team. That's the thing.
And being looked at as the savior and having to carry the burden of being that, you know, on a team that was already, you know, had 7-8 years of losing before you got here. You know, you already had the pressure of having to be the savior. So it's tough, man. It's tough. It really is. But that fucking chapter is over with.
It is.
Brady here for a few more years, and then we're going to have another young buck possibly, unless
Aaron Rodgers
comes in or something like that.
I'm calling it. 12 will be here. Aaron Rodgers will be here.
Another 12. I honestly can see – I really do see it happening. We'll just keep bringing 12s in. I really do see it happening.
Just keep changing 12s. Like that, like the Cleveland Browns have the, you know, the jersey. They keep different quarterbacks every year.
We'll just keep getting patches. 12s.
Only 12s.
We'll get new patches on the back of each jersey, man.
His contract becomes tradable in 2 years.
Perfect. Perfect timing, bro. Perfect timing.
Mike Evans isn't going to go anywhere. Godwin's still going to be here. OJ Price will be here. Gronk will be gone. The young people, like, think, I mean, it sounds fucking crazy, but where's he going to go? Minnesota?
I'm here for it. We don't ever have to draft a quarterback again. We'll just keep
drafting a quarterback.
Yeah. We'll just keep on bringing GOAT in.
We're just not one of those franchises that knows what they're doing when they draft quarterbacks. We're like the Cleveland Browns. Still, you know what? Stop taking the chance.
Bro,
let's just sign the guys who know what they're doing.
The Browns had Bernie Kosar, bro. We have nobody except for Doug Williams.
We had Trent Dilfer.
Yeah, Josh Freeman. What do you mean?
Hey, man, I like free. Don't talk shit.
Anyways,
man, this was fun hanging out with you guys.
Hold on.
We got way deeper in our feelings than I anticipated.
After Aaron, 4 years from now, we're going to get Russell Wilson.
It's going to keep going. And then we'll get P. Mahomes towards the end of his career. I mean, this could be the most winningest sports franchises ever.
Of all time. Dynasty.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to have more championships than the Lakers and the Celtics combined. Where are we even going to put all these trophies?
Boom.
We're going to be throwing.
We'll have at least two more in our case.
At least two
over the next 2 years. Yeah. They might be offseason. They might be offseason trophies, but we'll
still have. Let me ask you guys a question. Legit, before you say it's been fun and we got emotional and all that stuff, because you're going to go there, Sam, and that's fine. And we got to ready to get some.
I'm not doing that.
Anyway, if the Bucks make it to the Super Bowl, I know you literally the money sticks together. You make sure, Stank, like, make sure I'm giving you $2.
I peel my money when I hand it to people. It's the Jew in me. Oh, anyway, there could be one extra dollar right here attached to this.
If the Bucks make it to the Super Bowl, are we paying $7,000 and going to the game?
How are we going? Dude, we're going to the Super Bowl no matter – no, we're going
Sammer
to the
said Bowl. He's buying. I think he just said he's buying.
You're buying?
We are going.
So we are going to the Super Bowl. We're going to that fucking game. There's no way in our lifetime – like when the Bucks went to the Super Bowl last time, I was in high school. I was a senior in high school. There's no way I was going to a Super Bowl. All right, listen. I barely really got to enjoy that season and go to many games. I didn't have that. I wasn't, you know, I was in high school.
$7,000.
But now, if the Bucks are in the Super Bowl in Tampa, like, just no excuse. We don't got to travel. We're not out of towners. You know, all that added expense.
So Stank, you're saying you're going.
We live here.
If I have to sell, listen, if I have to sell world's finest chocolate bars to get an extra $7,000 in my pocket, if I got to have car washes, fucking fundraisers.
I'm going to GoFundMe.
GoFundMe's, all that shit.
Baby oil, a bunch of bikini-clad bitches, because that's what Beck's Baby Oil is really for. and we'll have them fucking put on car washes, bro. We'll fucking bang.
The bus? You bring the bus, bitches, and the baby oil. And yeah, that, and we give money.
Open the canopy so the bitches don't die.
We're big baller brand, triple
big baller brand. Buses, baby oil, and bitches. Put it on a t-shirt.
Oh my God. Baby oil, bitches, and buses, motherfuckers.
That's right.
Oh my God. That's how we end the podcast from now on.
Baby oil, buses, and bitches.
No joke. This was fun hanging out. I don't know if people have made it all the way through this and actually like watch it to the end. We appreciate everybody who does watch. We appreciate all the likes, all the comments, all the insight. If you guys want to share like anything that has to do with what happened in the news or the Bucks, leave it in the comment section.
Unless you disagree with us.
Reply. No, even if you disagree, all three of us reply. It's fun. And we appreciate all the subscriptions, all the likes, all the shares, all that good stuff. Yep. And you know, we're going to have some fun stuff coming up this season and we can't wait to, you know, it's going to be all of us. And when I say all of us, I mean all of Buck Nation. So, I don't want to say let's end this podcast the way we always end it. So
we're going to end it. We're going to end it the only way we know how.
Peace.
Boo-foo. Boo-foo. Buy us. Fuck you.
12-year-old Turkish boys.
BBB. Bitches, buses,
and baby oil.
And baby.